Hello and welcome everyone to our final day of spring break at the COC Exploring New Opera. I can barely believe how quickly this week has gone by, and I've enjoyed every minute of our conversations and our time together. My name is Mackenzie Morgan, and it has been an absolute pleasure to be your host this week as we uncover many of the diverse paths that are available within the creative field. Before I introduce our final guests in this digital series, I will be acknowledging three specific ancestral lands today in honor of the traditional lands of where I am broadcasting from and from where our guests are tuning in across the country. From the East Coast to the West Coast, what a privilege it is to recognize my Indigenous brothers and sisters who are rooted on Treaty 4 land, situated on the territories of the Cree, Salto, Dakota, Lakota, Nakota, and the homeland of the Métis and Mi'kmaq nations. I also acknowledge the ancestral lands of where our guest, Julie McIsaac, is broadcasting from, which is the lands of the Lekwungen people, known today as the Songhees and Esquimalt nations. Lastly, we also acknowledge the ancestral lands of where Dr. SarahRose Black is broadcasting from, and where many of you have been tuning in all week. My Indigenous brothers and sisters who are rooted on Treaty 13, situated on the territories of the Mississaugas of the Credit, the Anishinaabeg, the Chippewa, the Haudenosaunee, and the Wendat peoples. We acknowledge you. Wow. Today, ladies and gentlemen, we are in for a treat. Dr. SarahRose Black is a music therapist and psychotherapist who is a part of Fantasma and a part of the team. And Julie McIsaac is the dramaturge and director of Fantasma, which is our upcoming original opera for young audiences. So at this time, I'd like to introduce and welcome both Julie and Dr. SarahRose.
Hi, everybody. Hi, everyone.
How are you all doing today?
Really thrilled to be here. I've been tuning in through the week, and it's really fun to join here on day 5 and to talk to all of you.
Great.
Agreed. Such a privilege to be here, and so inspiring to see the work that the COC has done, not just this week, but leading up to and ongoing.
That's great. Well, we have a plethora of questions here, and we're going to jump right on in. And this question is going to be for both of you, and maybe Julie, we'll start with you. You are the director for Fantasma. What does it mean to be a stage director? And when did you know that this was something that you wanted to do? Was it something that you pursued, or was it something that kind of came to you?
Yeah, Mackenzie. Well, actually, directing, and I'm also the dramaturg of Fantasma, and I'll talk about what that is too. But both of those things, being a stage director and a dramaturg, when I was growing up, I didn't know those things were options. They weren't jobs that I knew existed, or let alone that it was something that I could do. And so when I was growing up, Ian mentioned this on day one. So Ian, who's the composer of Fantasma, we're actually from the same little community about a 2-hour drive north of Toronto. And my mom's from a big French-Canadian family. And my grandfather, my papere, played the fiddle when he was in a band. And my mom's one of 9 girls. And a lot of my aunties played music and had played in that same band with my papere. So there was always a lot of music where I was growing up. Wow. And my dad was really into music as well. He always had this really eclectic music collection. So anything from jazz and country and bluegrass and all like the greats of the Western European canon as well. So Beethoven and Brahms and Mozart. So there was always a lot of music going on. So that was something that felt natural to me and felt natural for me to then participate. So I took piano lessons, and I played the violin, and then I played the oboe in my band in high school.
And
yeah.
Oh, cool.
I think you actually have a photo of me at the piano. And I think here I'm a teenager, so I'm in high school. And what's really significant to me about that period of my life was that that's when I discovered that music and storytelling through music was a way that I could sort of explore who I am and the what I feel and what's important to me. And that was a way for me to connect with that really strongly and then to put that out into the world. So that was something that was a really important phase, I think. And then, but again, I wasn't really thinking about it professionally. And when I first went to university, I wasn't thinking about having a professional career in music or theater or anything like that. But eventually I found my way there. It took me a while. So I did, you know, theater with the little amateur theater company at my university. And then eventually after my undergrad, I went to theater school and I got to dabble in directing and playwriting too. So that's when I started to kind of get hooked on that. And I think what it was that drew me in was the idea of having something exist in your imagination and then getting together with a group of people to take that imaginary vision and to make it happen in three dimensions and in real time out in the world. Mm-hmm. And I think once I got a taste of that, it was just really addictive and really delicious. So that's how I sort of first got a taste for that. And the dramaturgy piece is really exciting because that's a way that just like someone who's writing a novel might then give the draft of that novel to a friend or to an editor to get some feedback and to figure out how they can clarify it and sort of make it the best they can be. As the dramaturg, I'll work with playwrights or with composers and librettists to sort of ask them questions and to be a reflective surface and sort of a guide and a helpmate as they create the work that they want to put out into the world.
What an important role. And the fact that, you know, it just kind of seems as though you had certain experiences mm-hmm. that, you know, that gave you the opportunity to find this way, which is incredible. And to be able to kind of take that and run with it and now here we are.
mm-hmm. And I'm just so grateful to all that. I had so many great teachers when I was growing up and also people who just recognize something in you and say, hey, you might be interested in this. You might want to give it a try. So I think it takes a whole community to raise an artist, just like it takes a community to raise a child. So yes. I'm grateful to all those people who sort of helped point me in a direction as I was growing up and then, you know, developing my practice as a professional too.
Yes, yes. And for you, Dr. SarahRose Black, you are both a music therapist and a psychotherapist. So I think before we begin anything, can you maybe just define the two and just give a bit of clarity on what that means?
Absolutely. Great question. And I call it the million-dollar question. What is music therapy? Because I get asked all the time because there are lots of different answers. But in short, a music therapist is a trained clinician or professional who uses music in a therapeutic way to support clinical goals, we call them. So using music to support mood management, anxiety, pain, self-expression, emotional support, even things like physical rehabilitation. Music therapists help train people to walk again after brain injury, help people to speak again after complex things happen that force individuals to have to find new ways to communicate. So a music therapist is someone who uses music in a clinical fashion and is always a trained professional. So someone who has a credential, either as an MTA in Canada, music therapist accredited, or an MTBC, music therapist board certified in the States. And that varies throughout the world. But that's a little bit about our profession.
Wow. Oh my, and so when did you know, like, were you a musician before and kind of fell into kind of the socio and emotional side of things? Or how did you come about becoming a therapist?
Great question. So I was a musician. I am a musician. And from, I think, about the age of 4, I was put into piano lessons and found that I really loved expressing myself through music. And I trained as a classical pianist. I also learned violin through high school and did some singing as well through university. But I knew that I loved music and I knew that I loved teaching and performing. So I developed a practice as a private piano teacher through high school and then through university where I studied music education and piano. And I found that as I pursued this path as an educator and I was teaching people about music, people, especially young people, were coming to me with more than just music. They were coming to me with ideas and thoughts and mental health concerns and emotional stuff that really moved me. And I felt I was in this privileged position somehow in this musical relationship to be able mm-hmm. to provide a space for people to feel safe. And I thought, oh my gosh, this is about more than just the music, isn't it? It's about.
Yeah.
So that then propelled me to look closely at what it would mean to study what music really does to human emotion, or how it impacts people on a more socio-emotional level, as you said. Mm-hmm. And I finished my graduate work in music ed and then went on to do graduate training in music therapy, followed by my accreditation as a music therapist at Wilfrid Laurier University. And in Ontario, most music therapists are also registered psychotherapists. So we belong to both colleges, essentially,
college.
The College of Psychotherapists and the Canadian Association of Music Therapy. Though you don't have to, you can practice in different ways, but that happens to be my practice and my the way I see people and patients.
Wow. What a story. That's incredible. But we'll talk a little bit more about this, how music is very much a vehicle and a tool to express some of the nonverbal, things and themes and feelings that sometimes it's hard to do in person, but music is a way of doing that. We will definitely touch on that a little bit later. But I am curious. It seems as though for both of you, the road was not straight. It had some bends and some turns, and because of that flexibility that you allowed, you found a path, that kind of came out of need or out of just even discovery, which I think, in this day and age, I don't think there are many straight lined careers anymore. So if there were viewers who were listening who might be interested, either in stage design or dramaturge or music therapy, how would they maybe gain experience, or how would they, if they're listening to this conversation and this excites them and they think, this is something that maybe I would connect with, are there paths that they can, or experiences that they can have, and this is for both, obviously, for both of you, that they can kind of obtain to gain experience and to just be a bit more to understand the industry a bit more?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, well, something that was available to me when I was growing up is there was like a community theater, in my hometown. And thankfully, that was something that we could participate in for free or for very little cost. Mm-hmm. So it was just sort of looking around, even though I was in a really small town, just sort of seeing what was available and where were people making music together or telling stories together. And then also the things that happened at my school, like the programs that were there in terms of music and drama, which I know isn't always the case. I know I'm very privileged that my school had that. And that's a larger conversation that we could get into. In terms of access to training and opportunities. But I think one thing that I really remember is at one point I had to audition for something or try out for it, or even just put my name forward, sort of to like stand up or put my hand up and say, yeah, I want to do that. Yeah, I'm interested. And I remember being really scared to declare that interest, like in front of my peers, in front of the other kids in my class, or in front of the other kids at the school. And in retrospect, I'm so glad that I did, because it led to some really amazing things. But I guess what feels important to me is that if you have that interest, or you feel something's bubbling up inside of you in that sense of, I feel like I would enjoy doing this, that even if there's fear associated with it in terms of what people might think of you, or that you might not do it well, or you might not pass the audition or get accepted into the program or what it is, that it's worth just trying, and to honor yourself by putting that interest forward, by speaking aloud, yeah, I like this. Yeah, I'm interested in this.
And I would dare say that the times that you do that, the universe also hears and listens, and things begin to move. Things will begin to move in your favor. That's a great statement, Julie. Dr. Rose, what about you? Is there anything that experiences that maybe a high school student could find, or I don't know. I don't want to say. So I'll let you discuss.
Totally. And I'm so moved by Julie, what you just said about taking a chance, even if it feels scary, and knowing that it's okay, even if it doesn't work out exactly as you thought it would. Taking that leap can often lead to unexpected and amazing opportunities. I felt that way starting music therapy school. I was terrified. I didn't know what I was getting into. And it was one of the best decisions I've ever made. But I'm thinking in terms of a young person, whether you're in high school, you're in university, you're thinking about high school, and you're interested in music or interested in healthcare, something, some combination therein, pay attention to that. I would encourage you to read about it as much as you can. There's some really cool documentaries out there online, on Netflix, on like various platforms. But the number one thing, don't be afraid to reach out to a music therapist. There are tons of us working in different parts of Canada and different parts of North America. We're fairly easy to find. Musictherapy.ca, get a whole list of music therapists. Email us. We're a really friendly bunch. It's what I did in high school. I reached out and I said, what exactly do you do? Can I talk to you for 20 minutes? I encourage you to reach out because we're all so different. And we can give you a sense of what a typical day looks like, what our career paths look like. The other important thing, which I found really supported me, even though I didn't really realize it at the time, I understand that COVID put some restrictions on this, but if you can volunteer as a musician or as a performer or an artist in a healthcare setting, you will find what clicks and maybe what doesn't click in terms of what you are interested in. So I did some volunteer work at the Center for Addiction and Mental Health, so CAMH in Toronto, and it's a hospital, and I would go and I play the piano for an hour a week. And the people I met and the stories I heard and the emotional reactions I witnessed, they provided so much inspiration and momentum for me to pursue the career I am in now. And I work in cancer care now primarily, but I encourage you to look for volunteer opportunities. They're out there. Talk to a music therapist. Pay attention to that voice inside of you that's pulling you in a direction. And don't ever stop reading about things, watching things, getting excited about things.
Yeah, those are some excellent, excellent points. And what I'm hearing as a kind of a bit of a theme between the both of you is that mentorship is important, and connecting and finding and building those relationships within either of those fields is a great way to begin that journey into the industry. So awesome points from both of you. Thank you so much for that insight. Julie, we're gonna move to you for a little bit as the director for Fantasma. We have heard from everyone this week. We've heard from the composer. We've heard from some of the artists. We've heard, you know, from the props and the stage and hair and makeup. And so they all come back to you. All of those conversations, you know, every single person has said that creative process, that you are that common denominator within those meetings and the process of kind of driving this forward. So the million-dollar question for you is, what inspired your creativity for this project? How did you come up with the ideas and the colors and the themes? How did it all come together?
Yeah, well, it begins with, and this is related to what Ian shared on day one. So it starts with that initial idea that Ian and Colleen are putting out into the world, and the impulse that they started with in terms of the location was really important to them, right? The idea of this carnival and the people, disparate groups of people meeting in this carnival space. And alongside that, I'd say something that was very clear to me in terms of their vision from the beginning is this balance of light and dark. So, and I think we heard a little bit of that in the music excerpts that were shared in the early sessions this week around like that fun, wonky, you know, weird carnival music. And then thinking back to what Alex played on day two, that solemn promise music that has much more of that emotional core and sort of registers in us much more on a deeper level, so that the light and the dark coexist. They live right up against one another. And that's part of, so Colleen Murphy, the librettist, that's really part of a lot of her work, where the light and the dark are really close to one another. And because that's life, right? You can be laughing at a moment and then crying the next, because we're all on this crazy roller coaster and we don't know where it's going next. So it was very important to me to honor that impulse in the work and honor both of them, which means means if it's going to be funny, let's lean into it and let's have a really good time. Let's have a laugh and let's be goofy and over the top. At the same time, when it then becomes time to breathe deeper and to let things hit us in a deeper and on a more emotional level to create the space and to create the atmosphere that's going to support that. And something that it's been mentioned a few times this week around the tent, the idea of the carnival as a place and as a setting. So when I think about the tent, there's like this physical aspect to it. So the idea of like the circular notion of the tent and what happens in that circle. And then I also find myself thinking about a lot of the people that you've met through the sessions this week, like the designers and the people who are building the props and the costumes and the people who are going to be on stage and who have created the music. To me, that's like the sort of the half of the circle, like the 180 degrees over here. But then the other half of that circle is the audience. And so something's going to happen. There's going to be an energetic exchange between what the team here at the COC has created and then what we create with the audience when they come and join us in that moment. And this relates a little bit with SarahRose's work as well, in the sense that because of we're aware of the fact that the audience is a key player in that sort of circle of experience that we're creating, we've been asking ourselves a lot of questions around the impact that this work might have on the audience, particularly the fact that we know there are some sadder and darker themes that do come into the story. So there's that fun of the carnival, but there's also these other layers that are in there. And so we thought, why not bring SarahRose and other people with her kind of expertise into the conversation to help us unpack and sort of do some troubleshooting and some planning around that.
And that is, you know, that to me is not only responsible, but it is needed, you know, when we begin to unpack and find more layers and discover more, it just opens the door for more community and for more people to become a part of that conversation, and to help in whatever ways that you can. Another theme that we spoke about throughout this week was this idea of collaboration, which really is community in its own way. And it is such a opera is such a multidisciplinary form that we are lucky really to have all different types of people from all different types of walks of life that have to come together in order for it to be to succeed. So you know, as Julie, as a large part of your role is collaborating with the creative team and bringing different artistic practices together to form this sense of community. From your perspective, and then I'm going to take it to Dr. SarahRose, but from your perspective, what is the importance of having a healthcare professional as part of the creative process? We spoke about that in terms of Fantasma, but you know, there might be even other productions that could be used in that way. Mm-hmm. And then Dr. SarahRose, I'll ask you that same question from your perspective, from a clinical perspective as well. We'll start with Julie.
Yeah, well, for me, and I think this is something that's been particularly evident during this COVID period where we're not able to attend live performance events like we would in the regular times, is that I realized to what extent my artistic experiences are equally a part of my health and well-being, just like the vitamins that I take every morning to sort of keep my bones and my skin and everything, you know, working the way it should. So there's... I see these things as having equal weight. So what I mean by that is that music is an artistic tool. It's an expressive tool that we use as artists, as professionals, but it's also something that can profoundly impact and shape people's well-being and their health. And so given the fact that that is a belief that I hold dear, and given the fact that that's something I consider when we're putting musical and artistic works out into the world, I'm really honored that Dr. SarahRose is on this journey with us to help to ask some questions and to help us keep things in mind as we're readying this work to share with young audiences who might be there with their friends, or you might be there with your parents or with your school group and your teacher. But it's just really nice to have SarahRose there sort of looking at things through her lens and offering some things for us to keep in mind, particularly because there are some darker and challenging things, and we hope that people feel deeply. I think it's really mm-hmm. important to Ian and Colleen to put something out into the world that is going to engage people on an emotional level. So we just want to make sure that we're thinking about that in as holistic a way as possible.
You know, Matthew on Tuesday, he had mentioned that, you know, during COVID even, there are times where people feel as though they can't necessarily want to feel emotions just because of all of the distractions and all of the things that are going around. So having that perspective, Julie, is uplifting to me, because it allows the audience to go back to that emotional point, which, you know, in theater and in opera, that is such an important part of opera, is the emotion. So it's interesting that you've connected that emotional aspect as well. So Dr. SarahRose, from your perspective, what do you see?
You know, it's been a total privilege to be able to weigh in and collaborate with the team on Fantasma, because of, I think, the profound acknowledgement and respect that the team has for the power of the music and the art and the messages that are being conveyed and the experience that is being created. And to be able to come with my lens, yes, as a psychotherapist, but also as a musician who works with people and their emotions in music every day, it's mm-hmm. such an honor, because there is such a magnitude. Like, there's something so profound that happens when we are moved by the arts. And I would say now more than ever, as we are in this really intense time as humanity, in our world, to be able to acknowledge that life is really hard sometimes and life is really amazing sometimes. And as Julie pointed out, the light and the dark, we hear it in music, we feel it in our emotions, we experience it in our day-to-days. So to make a very obvious connection between our mental health and our experience of the arts as supportive for our mental health, arts as provocative, arts as acknowledging the struggles mm-hmm. that we have. There are so many different ways to approach it. And I think doing it as a team with multiple perspectives is, as you said, Mackenzie, responsible, because it can stir up a lot of uncomfortable things. It can stir up a lot of deeply moving and cathartic things. Like, you might walk away from a performance in tears. That's not necessarily a bad thing, but we want to make sure that if we are offering something so powerful, that we are also balancing it with tools and perspectives and support, and this word that is so critical in our day and age, but, you know, always, safety, psychological safety, and knowing that however you receive the art, you are supported, you are not alone, and there is, and you are, it's a normal experience to just react however you react. Mm-hmm.
I love that. I don't think anyone could say it any more clearer than that. It is so important to have that outlet, that when you receive, whatever way that you receive, that there's a safe place for you to express what happens after you receive that. That was such a beautiful way of saying that, Dr. SarahRose. Wow. Do you think it's important? You know, I think about my artistic practice just personally as a singer, and I never considered enlisting mental health professionals in my journey. And I think, you know, just thinking back now, how helpful that could have been for some of the tougher situations that we all go through. But specifically in music, you know, singing is a very personal thing and it's a very intimate thing. And I think sometimes the relationships that you have with yourself can be reflected through that. And so, you know, something that might not be as, I guess, maybe common knowledge, are people able to call and enlist mental health professionals for their artistic practices? Like, if you are a singer, or if you are not even maybe singing, it could be an acting, it could be any kind of area of the arts. But is that something that should be normalized, and B, something that maybe can be more widely spread throughout the industry?
Yes. Yes to everything you are saying, and your beautiful way of articulating this need. I think as a singer, you are a human being expressing a profound spectrum of emotion using your body. And that is hard, and that is intense, and that is amazing. And anyone who is performative or expresses anything through the arts is by nature inviting vulnerability, inviting intimacy, inviting intensity. And this can be at any stage or any age, really. I've seen this in little kids. I've seen this in folks in their 80s and 90s. When we feel moved, connected, and we are expressing, it is a highly vulnerable space to be. And, you know, now more than ever, it's not easy to be in the arts. And it's also the most amazing thing to be in the arts. It's all of it. It's the light and the dark.
It's the light and the dark.
Mental health for artists of all kinds is so important. I feel my body reacting as I say these things, because I struggled with within my performance practice. I've struggled with all kinds of different mental health scenarios and experiences. And now more than ever, we're seeing embedded training in the more classical realm, like performance psychology and how to address things like nerves and overwhelm when we are performing. But I'm heartened to see more opportunities for artists to engage with their mental health. There's a beautiful artist health center as part of one of the hospitals downtown at Toronto Western. Mm-hmm. But beyond that, you are an artist and you are a human. Therefore, I'm a personal believer that every human being requires mental health care and support no matter what. But because you are in this space of vulnerability and intimacy, I encourage it so much that at regular intervals, if not kind of on an ongoing basis, you check in with your mental health and you reach out for support, whether it's through a psychotherapist, a professional, a counselor, a peer group. It's vital. It's actually vital to sustain your practice and to be able to continue your practice in a healthy way.
Absolutely. I love to see how the industry is growing and moving, and in its diversity, we still draw all of these different areas that, you know, even 7 or 8 years ago, no one really kind of had that at top of mind or could consider that. But as we move along, especially as you said, during the time that we're in right now, it's so important to acknowledge that and to make sure that we have those tools are available so that people know it's okay, and that help is there, or those safe spaces, as you've mentioned, are there for the artist. So Julie, we on Monday, Ian and I chatted a little bit about Fantasma, and I love this, you know, I love how you contrast this light and dark. I think in terms of the soundscapes, that's kind of where Ian has seen that light and that dark and has paralleled that. Mm-hmm. But in terms of the physical world of Fantasma, how did you go about creating and envisioning that light and dark, those themes and those scenes from a physical, those physical perspectives.
Yeah, I'm so excited to talk about that and to mention designers on the team and to credit their work and show some images of it as well. That'll be coming up soon. But just before I do, I just want to build on something that you were both saying a few moments ago, Ron. When I think about the artists who are going to be performing this work, or when I think about the audience who will be attending this work, I find myself thinking about, like, you know, someone who's going to run a race, like someone who's trained an athlete at the top of their game. You know that pose that they have, like, before the pistol goes off, where they're like ready to go and they feel like, you know, they feel so excited and so bold and so bravely ready to go forth. Like, that is what I hope. So when we talk about putting these supports in place and how we can, you know, think things through and make sure people feel supported, it's in order for them, for where I'm coming from, is like, because I want them to feel like they can boldly enter the adventure ahead. whether they're a customer, whether they're an audience member, that they feel ready and that they feel like they can, when that pistol goes, that they can just, you know, dive in with both feet. And so, you know, I've the language is like safe space. And also I've been hearing some language around brave space. Yes. Which is exciting too, to think about how do we have the skills and the strategies and the tools in place so that people feel supported and feel bravely ready to set forth. Mm-hmm. So this is all great, exciting conversation. But getting back to the physical piece, Mackenzie, around the space. So with that light and dark, and knowing that it's been mentioned a few times this week that it's a short piece, so it's a one act piece, which means we, for example, we don't have an intermission halfway through to sort of change everything around. So we needed to proceed with something that simple and yet something that had a capacity to transform, so that when we wanted to have things that were in this more lightly fun carnival world, we could do that. And yet when things need to be a bit more spooky or have more mystery or have a bit more of a darker atmosphere, that we could do that too. And in this respect, I'm really grateful that we also have a lighting designer, Michael Kangas, on the team, in addition to Camelia Koo, who's our set and costume designer. And maybe we can throw up one of those images right now. And here you'll see the this is a maquette. It's sort of a model that Camelia Koo has created. And what I'll bring our attention to is the way the light is featured.
Yes.
So how the light is shining on the people so you can see them clearly. And maybe if you're looking at this image at home, you can start thinking about what time of day might this be, or what kind of feeling does this give me in terms of that spectrum of light to dark. And then if we go to the next one, so here we see there's more shadows, and we see that our focus is also really clearly on that one figure who is light, brightly lit, whereas there's a lot more shadow and a lot more darkness around some of the other people. And so for me, that atmosphere starts to change. There starts to be more mystery, more intrigue. It feels like it's something's registering to me on a deeper level. And then we'll go to that final one. And again, here we see contrast again with much more light. So all that to say is that the collaboration that's going to happen between the set elements and the lighting elements are going to be really important to help us have this one simple setting and this, and yet for us to be able to transform it and move through light and dark and everything in between.
I got to say, I love that set. I think it is the simplicity, but also the intensity that allows the theme for light and dark to be so clear. I keep saying this every single day, but I really am so excited to see this on the stage. All of the combinations just coming together there. That's beautiful. A beautiful way of, from the music to the stage, from the props, everything, you can kind of put it all in perspective. You know, throughout this journey, especially with COVID-19, we've had to deal with setbacks, and we've had to deal with, you know, maybe going from to plan B instead of plan A. Not only in theater, but in life as well. Just with this entire year, our whole lives have been turned upside down for the most part. And we've really had to readjust and reimagine, imagine this year. But we don't live in a society that takes too lightly to that. Ian and I spoke a little bit about how, you know, we live in this Instagram, everything must be perfect, you know, filtered world that isn't realistic, that doesn't promote growth or any type of, you know, any type of tangible understanding. So both Ian and I, we focused a bit on how mistakes and going through failures is not a failure. Even just that word, you know, it is a juxtaposition. It's actually not a failure. It's an avenue, and it's a way for more learning. So Julie, for you, what is the biggest lesson that you've learned from making a mistake? It doesn't have to be Fantasma related, but just in general. And how did this mistake improve your craft?
Yeah. Well, and unfortunately, it's a mistake I've made more than once, which makes me feel like, why haven't I learned my lesson yet? Why haven't I, solved that problem? But what it is I think that pressure that I feel to have all the answers. So I think there's a fine balance to be struck that as the director of a production, and given that there's a responsibility to pull together all these threads, right, and communicate with all the different people and make sure everyone has what they need and that everything is happening and happening on time and on budget and all that, you're kind of constantly thinking about all those things and you know, knowing people need to take breaks at certain times. So there's a lot of balls that you're juggling. And because of all that, I do think it's important that the director have a sense of vision and a sense of destination, because I think that helps people on the team to sort of, you can all look to the horizon together and go like, okay, that's where we're going. That's where we're headed. That's where we want to get to. And I think it's important to be able to have that and articulate that clearly to the team. At the same time, I think there's space for us to not know things. And I think, or this is what I've learned. Sorry, what I should clarify is that this is what I've learned. Is that it's important for me to do my homework and to be prepared and to spend some time refining and building that vision so I can help inspire and get people on board so we can work together to achieve it. But there are going to be people on the team who are older than me, who are more experienced than me, or maybe it's not even a question of age. They just had different experiences and they see the world differently. And by virtue of that, they're going to be able to offer solutions. So if I think about that metaphor of like crossing the sea, you know, to get to that place on the horizon, is like when things get stormy and we get off course, which happens in any sort of process, I might not be the person who has the best solution to get us back to those calm waters and to get things smoothly again. So it's to trust yourself and to trust your team to and to be humble enough to say, I don't know, what do you think? So, and I know Sandra and Sharon sort of alluded to this the other day, and it's so true because they know what they do so well. They have all these strategies and all these sort of tricks in their pockets. So to really really look to everyone on your team and to not be afraid to say, I don't know, can you help me?
Absolutely. And Dr. SarahRose, just from a personal perspective, you know, I was a teacher, a classroom teacher for 10 years. And the biggest theme that I saw through, and I taught from little ones all the way up to, you know, grade 11 and grade 12, was that people were afraid to make mistakes. They did not want to fail. They did not want to, you know, even if it was to get a bad grade. It was such a struggle and a process. And I realized, you know, during my time teaching that it would be so helpful to have strategies and pathways to understand failure. And I'll put that in quotations for lack of a better word. But to understand that failure and mistakes are actually a way to move forward. So for you, I'll ask the same question, and I'm sure it will be such a different answer, but how do mistakes improve your craft? And how can you help someone to see that and to verbalize that? Maybe if you have a friend who's going through something and they're just so down, they're down on themselves, they're not feeling great. How can we as people share that mistakes are not always a bad thing?
This is such a profound and important conversation to have, especially in the context of huge distress and grief. And I don't just mean grief in terms of losing somebody, although that may be the case, but grief in terms of loss of what we may have expected of ourselves or expected of the year. And expectation is what comes to mind when I think about the word mistake or the word failure, that sometimes we may have expectations of ourselves that are maybe unrealistic, maybe problematic in some way, maybe really challenging. So I like the term, the idea of managing our expectations. So mm-hmm. if the world is really messy right now and really complicated, maybe we can manage our expectations of what we are able to do and remind ourselves that we are human. So managing our expectations and normalizing the fact that everybody, every single person in the world will have moments where they do something and it doesn't feel right. It feels wrong. It feels like a mistake. It feels like it triggers insecurity. It feels sad. This is super normal. And I've had countless experiences like that personally. In my work, I see it all the time. So managing what we expect of ourselves. And in terms of offering care and support to somebody who feels as though they have made a mistake or failed at something, recognizing that everyone does it and also acknowledging that we're so good at giving care to other people, it's often the hardest thing to turn that care around and give ourselves that compassion. So giving yes. ourselves that hug and saying, you know what? That's okay. That's life. And it's going to happen. We can expect that things are going to happen that don't make us feel good. And we can keep going because we're all really in it together. And I've spent a lot of time doing things at work where, especially as a music therapist, where I think, oh my gosh, I'm no good at this. And so insecurity, you know, I'm doing this wrong and I don't have a place in healthcare. What is a musician even doing in a hospital? Like these profound feelings of imposter syndrome and insecurity. So managing my own expectations, normalizing these ups and downs of the tough work that we all do to get up in the morning and face the day, and giving ourselves the compassion we are so good at giving to other people.
Mm-hmm. That is great advice. I know I will be taking some of your points and using them for myself. Yes, absolutely. Well, you know, we do have some questions from some of the viewers. But before we get there, I have one more question for you. And then we'll move into some of our questions that our viewers are watching. But just lastly, just to wrap up Fantasma for this entire week, why should someone come and see this production? In particular, Fantasma. We've talked about so many different things over this week: the light, the dark, the sounds, the experience. Wolf talked about it being very immersive. Mm-hmm. Why do you both think that someone would come and see this and be moved? Probably in a way that they wouldn't be moved if they saw something else. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I'll chime in first in the sense that when I hear adults or like long-term opera goers talk about why they like opera, they'll talk about the beauty of it, the emotional depth and how moved they are and the sort of the epic ride of the drama and the tragedy, if it is a tragedy. But often when we see works that are being created for young people, they're really fun and they're really cutesy. And I think that's great. I really love fun. But at the same time, I don't want to deny young people that heart of opera that grown-up opera fans really love. So yes. I remember the rich emotional life that I had when I was young. And I know that young people have an interest and a capacity for very deep feeling, that they feel mm-hmm. things deeply. They feel a huge range of emotions and they have rich inner emotional lives that are deep and true and intense. And so I invite you to come and see Fantasma because it is fun and goofy and it'll have those over the top moments, but it also packs this emotional punch. And I think young people deserve art that offers all of that.
Yes. Yes. Wow. That's a great answer. Oh my goodness. Dr. SarahRose, I don't know. It's up to you now.
I can't top that at all. That's such a perfect, perfect and inspiring way to encourage people to be immersed in all that art is. You spoke it so beautifully, Julie. Just something that I've been reflecting on as I've been privileged to be able to be a small part of the Fantasma process is the acknowledgement. I think the feeling seen when a young person or a person of any age shows up to the experiences of the characters in Fantasma, maybe there's something in it that they can relate to, or they can say, I've felt that. I've experienced that. maybe I'm not as alone as I thought. So this sense of community that happens when we target the dark and the light, when we really dive in, this sense of togetherness and this sense of the whole spectrum of human emotion as being welcomed and safe to explore. I think this is a really unique opportunity for that, for young people, but for people of all ages, and to not be afraid to take chances and explore, whether it's our own emotions or a dream that we have, to allow ourselves to do that. And to be able to do that with the Canadian Opera Company in such a beautiful venue with beautiful intention and art is such a gift. I'm so excited.
Wow. Well, I know that I will be in the front seat watching. I can't wait for this to be able to get on stage and to experience this with everyone. Well, time is running down and we do have some questions. So I am going to get into the chat here. And our first question is actually for Dr. Sarah Rose. Ewa on Facebook would like to know, how would you use music for children with anxiety? Mm. So if you have anxiety, how do you use music for children with anxiety?
This is such a good question. Thank you so much, Ewa. It's a big question, and I'm so glad you asked it. The first thing that comes to mind is music can match our mood, and music can shift our mood. So sometimes mm-hmm. it can be really helpful if we are feeling something, and the music we are listening to sounds the way that our feelings feel. So if you are, maybe if it's your own kids or kids that you're working with, and you know there's a huge sense of anxiety, if you're creating music, like maybe you have instruments at home or homemade instruments, what does anxiety sound like? Can you express that? Can you drum out anxiety? What is that? What does it sound like? And that can be a really engaging way for kids to say, to express what they feel without having to use their words, which can be really tricky, right? So can you make it sound like anxiety or like nervousness or nerves? Well, however you want to phrase that. So there's that. There's also listening to music that is maybe a bit faster or more energetic. Like I'm just pulling this off the top of my head, but Flight of the Bumblebee, there's this constant mm-hmm. movement that can seem a bit frenetic. And it might be actually empathic for a kid to say, I feel like that sometimes. That's it. And they can feel quite seen. The other piece is music to shift our mood. So first of all, there's the acknowledgement, but then if we do want to support a kid in moving through the anxiety, music that is grounding, music that is slower, music that maybe has certain instruments that a child might find comforting. I have a friend who uses harp music all the time with her little ones because they find it to be really relaxing, they say. But, mm-hmm. you know, can we close our eyes and listen to 1 minute of this beautiful harp? Can we pretend we're playing the harp? So asking the body actually to slow the heart through music is actually a literal physical way we can slow down this kind of upregulation, we might say, if a child is experiencing overwhelm. So choosing that's slow with certain instruments that a child will be able to sort of sink back into and relax with, even just for a few minutes.
I hope Oh my goodness, I'm going to be calling you Dr. Sarah Rose for some bullet sessions. I love what you said there about having that, like calming the body, because that really is, you know, music is that connector to the body, and having, you know, being able to have, you know, that music kind of slow that heart rate and bring us back to a sense of calm. Love that answer. Our next question, our second question is for Julie. And the question is, what type of skill sets do you think make a good director? And do you always continuously work on these skills?
Okay, great, great question. So I think one of the things I think about is that a director is a collector, in the sense that you're a collector of ideas, and those ideas you might then present as something on stage. So when I'm out and I go for a walk on the street, even, or a walk in a park, sometimes I see flowers, you know, arranged in a certain formation, and there's something about the shape of those flowers in that field that remind me of bodies and space and humans and connection and relationships. And that might seem a bit strange, but basically I think what I'm getting at is the fact that there's a whole world out there, both in terms of the natural world and in terms of people, which is related to what Ian was saying on day one, too, to be curious about people and human behavior and human emotion and interrelationships, because all those things can then be the inspiration for what you craft on stage. And also collector in the sense of, or maybe not less collector, but I think that collaboration is so important. And those soft skills that you spoke about with Sandra and Sharon, I think, Mackenzie, yes. in terms of figuring out who needs what when, and how can I support them so that when that curtain rises, they're going out there to do the best work they are capable of. And they're going to feel supported, and they're going to feel proud, and they're going to feel like they can just dive into the story, into the character, into the drama, and not give it another thought. That they feel confident, they feel safe, they feel prepared. So really sort of always having your spidey senses going around the room and trying to be aware of what all the needs are and how you can support or resource whatever those needs are. And then I think the thing about in terms of like, do you keep working on them? Absolutely, because I learn something new every time. And no two projects are alike, you know, just like building a prop, like all props are different and every production has its different requirements. So definitely there's ongoing learning that's going on all the time. And just I'm constantly being inspired by the world and the people around me too.
I'm going to take with me from what you said, Julie, I'm going to take with me that we are collectors. I love that. I love the idea that along the way you learn, you absorb, you grab, you connect. I'm going to be a collector. I'm going to add that to my vocabulary. if you can believe it, it is already that time to close off this session. So much knowledge I've learned today personally, and I just want to thank both of you so much for being our final guests on this digital series. I have a feeling we might need to bring this back once a year. This might be something that that hopefully stays within the COC repertoire. But again, just for sharing your insight and for sharing your knowledge with all of us today. Thank you so much for joining us. And for our viewers, if you want to learn more about Julie McIsaac or Dr. SarahRose Black, you can visit the website at coc.ca/springbreak. And as always, if you've enjoyed today's session and you would like to explore more of what digital offerings we have here at the COC, please jump on our website, Opera Everywhere at coc.ca/everywhere. And lastly, and definitely not least, but we are going to have our registration for our COC's virtual summer opera camp. It is now open and it is designed for, we have 2 weeks that are designed, one for grades 5 to 8, looking to explore the foundations of performance art, and the COC Teen Summer Intensive, which invites teens in high school to learn about professional singing careers through a week-long intensive with opera coaches from the COC. So to learn more or to register, you can visit coc.ca/summercamps. I can't believe it. It has been such a wonderful week. I have thoroughly enjoyed myself. What a wonderful way to end off this week, speaking to these dynamic women. We could speak for another 2 hours, I'm sure. But thank you so much again. And Dr. SarahRose and Julie, I know that once Fantasma is able to be up and running, it is going to be a special one. Wow. Very, very special.
Thank you, Mackenzie, for hosting this week. I think you've done a stellar job. And so I think just some time to kind of throw that praise to you. And also, I know people have met so many people during the week, but there's also people you haven't yet met. Believe it or not, there's even more people who are working on Fantasma and helping to make this possible and helping to make this week of programming possible. So I just wanted to take a moment to thank everyone as well.
Yes. Absolutely.
Completely. Thank you to the amazing COC. Julie, such a delight as always to share this space with you. And Mackenzie, you're incredible. Thank you for your great questions and for providing this opportunity for us to share.
All right. Yes. Well, with that being said, it is our time. I hope We will see you all on the other side of this pandemic and back in the Opera House while we are able to create and make music and perform once again. So thank you, everyone. I hope that you have enjoyed this spring break, and I hope that you're refreshed, ready to get back to it next week as we get through these last few weeks of school. So thank you so much for watching.